Welcome to Module 7, Lecture 1. We're starting our work on angular momentum. We're heading towards eventually solving the hydrogen problem, which can be solved exactly and is one of the most important problems that we can solve in quantum mechanics. So, angular momentum. As you probably recall from your classical mechanics, angular momentum is hard. And I think it's fair to say anyone who says they intuitively understand why a gyroscope precesses is probably lying to you. So the quantum theory of angular momentum must be doubly hard. Right? Wrong. It turns out that in quantum mechanics, we work with operators, their commutators, and the states. And while this procedure might be abstract, at no point do we have to visualize complex vectors in three dimensions that move in non-intuitive ways as you have to do so in classical mechanics. And so I actually think, as long as you can deal with the abstraction, in quantum mechanics, angular momentum is actually simpler than it is in classical mechanics. And I hope you will agree with me as we go through this. Why do we have to do this? Why do we care? Because the important forces, the Coulomb interaction in atoms, they're central forces. We also care because we need to deal with spin, and spin is an angular momentum. So the approach we're going to take for this orbital angular momentum is going to be very similar to what we did with spin. As you remember there, we focused a lot of time on developing the commutation relations of spin, of the spin operators with themselves. We did that by working through properties of the states. For angular momentum, especially with orbital angular momentum, which is what we're going to be working with here, we're going to focus primarily on the commutation relations as they're derived from the canonical commutation relation between position and momentum. All right, so first we have to define what quantum angular momentum is. In classical mechanics, I hope you remember that angular momentum is R cross P. And it's then natural to try to just define it the same way in quantum mechanics by simply elevating the classical position and momentum into operators. Now, in many cases, when we try to do this in going from classical mechanics to quantum mechanics, we run into operator ordering issues where there's ambiguity. We don't know which operator goes to the left and which goes to the right. But because in angular momentum, the products of position with momentum always occur for terms that are in different directions, like Rx with Py or Pz with Rx and so forth, there actually is no operator ordering issue because momentum and position always commute when they're in different directions. And so we simply define it the way that we said. We elevate that position and momentum into operators. Let's look at the three components. Lx is rypz minus rzpy. You can see it doesn't matter which side the r and the p's go because they commute. Ly is rzpx minus rxpz. Again, no problem. And lz is rxpy minus rypx. Again, no problem. All right, so let's start off by working out the commutators of position and momentum with angular momentum. So we're going to start with working out the commutator with position and angular momentum. We just write it out here. Lj is just the sum over k and l of epsilon jkl rkpl. I hope you remember that we're using this Levi-Civita fully antisymmetric tensor to write the cross product out. And you need to be able to work with that notation and with that representation of a cross product. We have already gone through that before in the class, and you need to go back and review that if you're having any trouble with it. We just substitute that in, and now the next step, we're going to pull that summation and the tensor out of the commutator because those are just numbers. And then we have to use the Leibniz rule. We have a product of an RK with a PL. So we have now two commutators, RK with the commutator of RI with PL and the commutator of RI with RK multiplied by PL. Of course, that second one is zero because position always commutes with position. And the first one I just evaluate from the canonical commutation relation. So I get an IH bar delta IL. Now that delta IL means I set L equals to I and I get rid of the sum over L. So I'm just left with the sum over K. And now what I'm going to do is I'm simply going to cyclically permute jki to ijk. And there we have our commutation relation of position with angular momentum. Now we're going to do the same thing with momentum, with angular momentum. We go through all the steps. We first write out the angular momentum in terms of the fully antisymmetric tensor. We pull the summation out. We use the Leibniz rule. We recognize that the commutator of pi with pl is 0. Commutator of pi with rk is minus I h bar delta ik. And so we work that out. We substitute in that canonical commutation relation. We then pull the minus I h bar out. And now all I'm going to do is I'm going to change the dummy index L to k. But you see, I want to get it in the form ijk. And to do that, I have to interchange the indices I with j. And that's going to give me a minus sign. And so I'm going to get plus I h bar sum over k epsilon ijk pk. Now, it is not a coincidence that these two have the same form. Anytime the commutator of an operator with angular momentum has this form of an IH bar, sum over k, epsilon IJK, the thing that I was commuting, either in this case it's position or momentum, whenever you have that form, the operator is called a vector operator. So that's just a name, but you need to really be able to work with these commutators themselves, as we're going to throughout this lecture and throughout the upcoming lectures that we're going to be working on. Okay, there's one more thing that I would like you to do. I would like you to pause right now and write out the components of these commutators, just so that you're clear exactly what they mean. So you should look at, say, Rx with Ly. You can make sure that your I and J components are always different, because when they're the same, you're going to get 0. So Rx with Lx is going to give 0 because of the completely antisymmetric tensor. I encourage you to write out what a couple of these different components are. These are very complicated commutation relations. They contain a number of different terms. So let's pause right now and have you go through that exercise yourself. Okay, thank you for going through that. Now we're going to continue. We're going to actually work out the commutator of r squared with angular momentum. So we just write r squared as the sum over I of ri operator, and that's commuted with the Lj. I pull the summation out. I now have to use Leibniz. And now we know what this commutator is. It's just written on the top of the page, so I substitute that in. And now I collect up my terms, and you can see I can pull out an IH bar, and I can pull out this epsilon IJK, and I'm left with an RIRK plus an RKRI. Now, you need to look very carefully at this. If I interchange I with K, what I'm going to find is the antisymmetric tensor is going to change sign, because epsilon KJI is minus epsilon IJK. And the RIRK plus RKRI, that just goes to itself when I interchange I with K. So under the interchange of I with K, this thing changes sign. And the only number that is equal to its negative is 0. And so we actually conclude from this that that commutator is equal to 0. Now, I find students often have trouble with that. I'm going to go back to the previous one. If you are having trouble with this, I recommend again that you pause the video and you write out explicitly what this is. For example, look at the case where I'm doing the commutator with Lx, and look at your sum over I and k when I and k are equal to yz and zy, and you will see you will get two contributions that have opposite signs and are going to cancel. You really need to do that just to make sure you understand how this works. And so please pause if you're having any trouble and go through that exercise. If you are already familiar with this, this is similar to what happens when we integrate a product of an even function times an odd function over a symmetric interval, and we find that that integral is always equal to 0. All right, so that's equal to 0. I can do the same thing now with p squared. But if you think about it, because p is a vector operator just like r, I already did the derivation, so we can immediately conclude that p squared with li with LJ, that commutator is also equal to zero. All right, we now have everything that we need in order to calculate the commutator of angular momentum with itself. That's what we're going to tackle next. And we simply write it out. What we're going to do is we're going to write out the definition of angular momentum for the Li term in terms of the completely antisymmetric tensor and the cross product. Then we're going to use the Leibniz rule to separate these two out. And now we use those commutators that we just derived on the previous page. I can substitute in for the commutator of PL with LJ and of RK with LJ. We substitute that in. We get these additional Levi-Civita fully antisymmetric tensors, and we get a product of position with momentum with indices that we have to be very careful to keep track of what those indices are. And now we actually have to look at this carefully. I have either a sum over k of epsilon ikl epsilon kjm, or I have a sum over L of epsilon ikl epsilon ljm. In both cases, I have a sum over one of the indices of the product of those two tensors. It is time for an identity. Now, many of you might be familiar with this identity. If you're not familiar with it, then I'm going to try to motivate for you exactly what this comes from, where this identity comes from. But if you still don't get it from this, you can look at things like Khan Academy videos on this, or Jeff Chasnoff has a series of lectures on multivariable calculus on Coursera. He has some interesting ways of going through this as well. All right, so recall that the tensor vanishes unless all of those three indices are different. That's true for the IJK, and it's true for the KLM. So that means that either, since the Ks are the same, that means, and I only have three choices, that means I and J must be one of the other two, as must L and M. And there are only two choices that arise. Either I is equal to L and J is equal to M, or I is equal to M and J is equal to L. Now, sometimes people have trouble seeing that unless we get concrete. So let's be concrete. Let's pick k equals x. That means I is equal to y and j is equal to z, or I is equal to z and j is equal to y. Those are the only possibilities for I, j, and k. But then that's also the similar thing for L and M. So either L is equal to y and j is equal to z and M is equal to z, or L is equal to z and j and M is equal to y. And that means that we either have a situation where I is equal to L and J is equal to M, or we have the situation that I is equal to M and J is equal to L. Please be sure that you understand this. It's really critical for understanding this identity. Let's now look at that first case. If I is equal to L and J is equal to M, well, then that product is epsilon IJK epsilon KIJ. I do a cyclic permutation of the epsilon KIJ, I can make it epsilon IJK, and you see then that I just have the product of these epsilons. And that's going to equal 1 if all three of those IJKs are all different from one another. But if I is equal to M and J is equal to L, I get IJK epsilon KJI. Now if I do a cyclic permutation, I get epsilon JIK times epsilon IJK. And I have to interchange the I with the J. That gives me a minus sign to get an epsilon IJK times an epsilon IJK. So it's minus epsilon IJK squared. And that's, of course, equal to minus 1. All right. So we have established this identity. Now, we're going to use it to find the following. We find that the commutator of Li with Lj is equal to IH bar. Let's look at the first case. If I have delta, I have a epsilon IKL epsilon LJM. So I have a delta IJ delta KM. That would be a delta IJ, and then the delta KM is going to look like a dot product of R vector operator with P vector operator. So I get a delta IJ R dot P. If I look at the other term, I have a minus sign. I have a delta IM delta KJ. So delta IM will make that P index an I, and it will make the K index a J. So I get minus RJ P sub I. If I look at the second term, that's epsilon IKL epsilon KJM. The term there that we have with the delta IJ, that corresponds to the second term with the minus sign in that identity. So I'm going to get minus delta IJ R dot P. And then the final term is the one with the plus sign. That's going to give me plus RI times PJ, because in that case, I'm taking M equals I and I'm taking L equals J. Okay, you really have to just sit down quietly, look at those indices, play around with rearranging them in cyclic permutations or interchanging them and giving you a minus sign, whichever way you prefer, in order to work this out. Again, I strongly recommend you pause the video and work this out for yourself if you're having any trouble. And once we have that done, you see the delta ij terms, they cancel because they have opposite signs. And what we're left with is ih bar ripj minus rjpi. Now, you should recognize that that combination, ripj minus rjpi, that is an angular momentum. It's the angular momentum of the k index when ij and k are all different. And the way that I guarantee that I have the k index with all ij and k different is to use the fully antisymmetric tensor. So we rewrite that as ih bar sum over k epsilon ij k lk. Now, you might be worried that that sum over k has a lot of terms in it. There's only one k term that's not non-zero. If you give me an I and a j that are different, there's only one k. And so that thing that has a sum over k really just has the one term, and it's really equal to this value that we had beforehand. Okay? So we've now established the commutation relation, and notice the commutation relation of angular momentum with itself is also a vector operator because it has the same form of the ih bar sum over k epsilon ijk of the thing that I'm taking the commutation relation with angular momentum. All right, so this is also the same commutation relation as we had with spin. We had an SI commutator with SJ was ih bar sum over k epsilon ijk SK. Go back and look at what we had for the commutation relations of spin if you don't remember that. All right, now we can use the exact same methodology as we did before when we looked at the commutator with R squared or with P squared, and we can immediately verify that the commutator of angular momentum with L squared is equal to zero. And it follows for exactly the same reason. Okay, what we find is we have a sum of an odd tensor with an even sumand, and that's just like multiplying an odd function with an even function and integrating over a symmetric integral, and you get that that integral is equal to zero, just like we get the summation is equal to zero because we have a net odd sumand because of the odd tensor. All right, that's been a lot of work. Let's summarize what we've gotten. We have established the commutation relation between angular momentum. It's the commutator of Li with Lj is ih bar sum over k epsilon ijk Lk. We have established that Li commutes with L squared. That's for every I, so Lx commutes with L squared, Ly commutes with L squared, and Lz commutes with L squared. We have also verified commutation relations for vector operators. Ri position with Lj is ih bar sum over k epsilon ijk Rk. Similarly for momentum, and we also verified that the squares of those operators, R squared and P squared, also commute with Li and with Lj. These commutation relations are really quite important. We're going to be using them a lot. It's really important that you remember them. You might want to write them down on a piece of paper and keep them with you for work that we're going to be doing with them in the upcoming classes and upcoming lectures. And now that then concludes the first part of lecture 1 of module 7.